Praise the Lord.
I don't think it was on.
Do or do not. Okay. Well, before we get started.
Good morning. Before we get started,
God works in mysterious ways.
You know, and only God can take something
bad
and turn it for our good. Which, of course, is my favorite scripture, Romans 8:28. For all things work for the good for those who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. Who's called according to His purpose? That's all of us, anyone who's saved. You don't have to be a pastor, a preacher, a teacher. You don't
have to be an elder,
a board member. You don't have to, you don't even.
You just have to be saved. If you're saved, you're called according to His purpose.
Plain and simple.
So,
the reason I say all that before I get started this morning with the message is that, and maybe it has something to do with the message. The message is
rethink.
Charlotte, because we're missing our beloved Cindy this morning, we put us on Facebook to send our message out, which I'll copy and put on YouTube here later.
And
she was afraid that during the prayer request that she had accidentally put us on Facebook. She may or may not have. Whether she did or she didn't, my concern is that if someone saw something or heard something that offended them, I want to apologize as a pastor. I don't believe anybody did. But just
in case, I want you to know
that everybody has people in their life who, for lack of a better explanation, have a way of trying our patience. And those people aren't always family, although they have a particularly special rub to be able to try our patience. And I'm laughing because I'm thinking about how very good I am at trying my family's patience and my congregation sometimes. So, so if somebody saw or heard something that they feel was not Christian-like, then I apologize. Know that we sometimes ask for prayer requests, and when we do, we share a few details. That's why we don't usually put that on our Facebook. So my wife is terrified. She thought she did that. I don't believe she did. It's just a mistake.
Nevertheless, let's
go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before your throne and thank you so much, Lord. I pray that you would just be with us, that whoever might be watching out on Facebook or YouTube, whether they're watching us live right now or they're watching us 10 years from now, that this message will be a blessing to them, Father. I pray that you would be with me and use me as your vessel, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, less of me and more of you. Let it be your words and not mine. In Jesus' name, amen.
Turn to the book of Genesis.
For those of you who are watching by Facebook, you know where the book of Genesis is? It's the first book. And there's 66 books
in this book. In case I'm just being silly, I'm just Genesis chapter
18. Are we still rolling, Char? We're good? We still got 113 people watching us? Okay, please don't lose the chair. I love you. You're perfect. Thank you. Sit down. Enjoy the message.
You're gorgeous. Thank you. Oh,
bless the Lord. All right. Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18.
And let's see here. Let's start at verse
31. Genesis chapter 18, verse 31.
And he said,
and he being here as Abraham, and he said, behold, now I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord. Preadventure, there shall be 20 found there. And he said, meaning God, I will not destroy it for 20's sake. And he said, O Lord, O let not the Lord be angry. Abraham speaking to God again, and I will speak yet but this once. Preadventure 10 shall be found there. And he said, I will not destroy it for 10's sake. And the Lord went his way as soon as he left communion with Abraham, and Abraham returned unto his place. Amen. So the message today is rethink. So for the few people that are here in service, and we're missing a number of different service because of transportation and COVID, some people who are just sick. sick in general. I believe it's just a virus, a cold or something. I don't think it's COVID. But for the few people that are in here, by a raise of hand and a show of fingers, that's those phalanges that are at the end of your hand. If you're missing a few because you were in the war, I thank you for your service.
How many
daughters, based on what we can tell from the Bible, because the Bible doesn't say exactly, specifically, but from what the Bible says, how many daughters did Lot have?
Vera, Steve?
You can't.
Okay. For those of you who can't
see behind you, which you shouldn't be able to,
many people raised
their hand and showed two. The reason I read the section of scripture I did is because the answer is actually four.
What? Lot had four daughters.
Now, why is this important? In general, there's so many things in the scripture that, for lack of a better word, are innocuous, meaning simply that are they're not trivial, but they're trivia. You know, who went here and who went there. For example, the shepherds came to, the wise men came to visit Mary and Joseph. How old was Jesus when they got there? He was 2 years old.
The scripture says.
Right.
So,
my question then, as a pastor, as a Christian, is why do we have a manger scene with three wise men? Because Jesus wasn't a baby. Again, it's not a point of contention. I'm not trying to start an argument or a debate. The scripture says plainly, let us come reason together. Reason together. Reasoning means you talk, I listen. Not you talk, I prepare to respond. It's you talk, I listen. I talk, you listen. And together, with the help of digging through the scripture and maybe the use of the internet or whatever tools you have, commentary books that you have, we come to a conclusion. Sometimes there are things in scripture that we come to the conclusion that we don't have an exact or specific answer. When the scripture says the streets are paved with gold, but they're clear and you can see through them, that's not the kind of gold that we understand. Because when we think gold, we think more of a yellowy substance. But gold, in its true purity, is very clear and transcendent. You can see through it. We can't explain exactly what heaven's going to be like. The scripture tells us to some extent that there are things that it leads to us. Psalms, especially. And David, King David tells us things that, that we can expect. And John and Paul, in the book of Revelation, tells us things that we can expect to see. How many different kinds of angels are there? I'm sure that there's a multitude of different kinds of angels, but we only know of seraphims and cherubims, and the Bible doesn't and archangels. The Bible doesn't specify every detail. What the Bible does do, though, is it provides us with a guide to be able to do the things that we'll need to, which is
to live a sanctified
life before our friends and family and neighbors and strangers and whoever, because Jesus died on the cross, because he shed his blood for us. As Brent was saying in the beginning of the service, that his sinless blood was the blood that was shed for us. No human sacrifice pre-Jesus in the flesh, pre-Jesus or post-Jesus, could ever provide us with a covering. God used animals temporarily because they don't have soul, because their blood, for all intents and purposes, was the closest form to innocent blood to cover us until the true Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, died for us. That's your pre-message. But the reason that I read this section of scripture in Genesis 18 and ask the question about Lot's daughters is this. I want us to take the opportunity, 2020, 2020, our hindsight is 2020. I don't think it's a coincidence that we have this COVID-19 pandemic situation, first of all, during an election year. I don't even care who you voted for. That's irrelevant to me. I don't think it's a coincidence that it happened in the year 2020. Hindsight is 2020. I think God's trying to get our attention. He wants us to focus on Him. Rethink. 2020 has been a difficult year across the globe because of COVID-19 and the pandemic, because of finances, because of debts, because of loneliness, because of everything that's associated with it. And God wants to get our attention because we're not giving Him what He is due. And what does He do? He says, if you love me, you'll obey me. What does a father tell his children? He says, how do you spell love? A child spells love T-I-M-E. A father spells love O-B-E-Y. Why do I want my children to obey me? Because I'm a stingy Scrooge, because I'm an ogre. I want my children to obey me because I have been around the block once or twice. And I know what's going to hurt them and what's not going to hurt them. I know what's good for them and what's not good for them. And just the same way our Father in heaven knows what's good for us and not good for us, He doesn't give us rules to bind us. He gives us boundaries to protect us and ensure our freedom. And if we'll stay within those boundaries are written and drawn in the blood of Jesus. And the Ten Commandments aren't necessarily specifically those boundaries, although they do help to define it some. The Ten Commandments came long after the promise that God gave Abraham. Ten Commandments were given to Moses to show the children of Israel, and i.e. the church, that we are sinful, and that we do need a Savior, and that we do need God the Father, and we do need the power of the Holy Spirit. But here in this section of Scripture, Abraham is talking to God and praying and pleading. Now I want you to picture this, okay? This is Abraham. God's promised him so much. Lot and him go out together. And Lot and him both are blessed so immensely that their herds, their cattle, their sheep, goats and all the different animals and their herdsmen and their wives and their children and their children's children grew so vastly, just exactly as God promised Abraham. You'll be like the sand in the sea, right? Your people will be spread throughout the globe, billions of people, right? Grew so big that Abraham and Lot had to come to a point because the herdsmen were fighting over who gets this grassy knoll and who gets this river and who gets this well and all that stuff. No different than we do today, except that we're not herdsmen. It's, oh, you parked your car on my driveway, or you had to drive through my grass to get to your thing, or your car parked this way and I can't back out of my driveway safely, or the mailman delivered the mail to you, being quote-unquote the younger, so to speak, the nephew, the I'm young and I know better than everything else. I'm speaking to you under 25s out there who still think that you know everything. God bless you. And then I know I look 25, but I'm almost 50. And he chose what seemed to be the grass is greener on the other side. Well, that area that he chose was the area where the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay. Now, these were no small city. I think as Christians perpetuate, and non-Christians or people who have not studied, even Christians who have been Christians for years who haven't studied the Bible, that's a whole other message for another time, think that Abraham and Lot and people from the book of Genesis lived like some sort of Neanderthals, like cavemen, and that's not true. When God created Adam and Eve, He created them with all the languages and all the races in them. When Cain killed Abel and received the mark on his head and left, he built cities. How did he build a city if he was an unga bunga caveman? Okay? Why? Because he wasn't. intelligence, okay? So the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah were no small city. Some scholars say it's upwards of 1.5 million people, okay? Think about that, okay? Many of us that live, that watch on YouTube and Facebook live in cities that are probably significantly less than 1 million people. We're in the Portsmouth area. My wife and I personally live in Kentucky, in Russell, Kentucky. And I think it's what, 8,000 people or something, not even 10,000 people. 1.5 million people, okay? So this is no small area. So this is where Lot goes. God, in talking to Abraham, explains to Abraham that there's a judgment coming to these cities.
For their
decision to not follow God, and not just not follow God, but to choose to go their own fleshly way and do whatever it is that they feel good. Listen to me. Sodom, the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah chose to do whatever felt good. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound like anything we see or hear today in the news or on the billboard or in our music? Some of the music I listen to that my children, or some of the music I hear that my children listen to, I can't even share with you some of the lyrics that are in there. But it's basically, get what's yours by any means, and if it feels good, do it. Well, that's very similar to what was going on in the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So Abraham pleads with the Lord and says, God, would you destroy a city
if it had 50
people, 45, 40, 30, 20, 10? And what's that point of all of this? I know some of you are thinking, oh, here goes another one of those pastors off on his anti-homosexual and bigotrist, and says, that's not it at all. Not it at all. Abraham, if you notice, stopped.
And if there's 10, why is that important? Maybe it's not important.
But it goes to the idea of rethink. If you read and study a little bit, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved, a workman may not be ashamed. Yes, Vera, exactly. Right? Rightly dividing the word of truth. What's the difference between dividing the word of truth and rightly dividing the word of truth? It's come reason together. It's coming together with men and women who studied God's word for years. It's coming together and not being offended because your brother who goes to church with you believes one thing about the rapture and you believe something else. It's about rethinking, okay? Abraham stopped at 10, and if you think about it, we know that Lot, when he was at, and this is in Genesis 19, it's about halfway through the chapter, verses 14 through 20, roughly, Lot entertained two angels that came to the city of Sodom to remove him and his family. Now, if you read closely, Lot went to see his sons-in-laws. Well, if you read that closely, you realize that there's two son-in-laws that he went to reason with and said, come, the angels have been sent here by heaven, by God, from heaven, to tell us it's time to go. Come with me and bring my daughters, okay? And these two men, for all intents and purposes, mocked them, basically said, you're a crazy old fool, in words that we would understand today, okay? Now, we know this because that's what the scripture says, but it also talks about two daughters that went with him and his wife as they left Sodom, right? But these two daughters were betrothed to other two men. Let's see, Lot, wife, daughter, son-in-law, daughter, son-in-law, daughter, daughter, betrothed.
10 people. Interesting that Abraham
would stop at 10. when God, and he was pleading with him. Why didn't Abraham go and say, if but only five, if but only three,
if but only one? Now, we could reason together all day long
as to why Abraham stopped at 10 or didn't stop, why God stopped, and whatever. The point is, you think.
Now,
I warned my congregation before we got started today, when you leave here, you're not going to like me a whole lot, because I'm going to say some things that probably are not very pleasant. And I don't mean that mean to you people who are listening, whether congregation or Facebook or wherever. But when Lot left, his two sons-in-laws didn't go with him. Those two daughters that were married to them didn't go with him. We speculate that there was no grandchildren from those two daughters, because the Bible doesn't talk about those grandchildren. Because why? Because when he left with the two virgin daughters who were betrothed, without their betrothed, without the two men that they were betrothed to, and his wife turned back and looked and turned to the pillar of salt, it left Lot with his two virgin daughters. And the scripture tells us that these daughters conspired together, and logically thinking, because they just saw two cities of well over 1 million people destroyed immediately.
We don't know the
exact how it exactly happened. There's speculation that it was some form of asteroids or something that obviously was controlled by God that created some sort of quote-unquote nuclear explosion like we would understand, and destroyed the cities, right? And the angels couldn't perform what God had sent them to do, being good servants, until Lot left. And Lot left, and Lot took his two virgin daughters who still lived in his household, and his wife. His wife missed what she had and turned to look to see what she was missing, turned to a pillar of salt. So his two daughters are thinking to themselves, it's just us and Daddy left on this earth.
We just saw two cities
of well over 1 million people destroyed by the Lord, because they chose to not just disobey God, but they chose to
vilely turn
their backs on the Lord and do everything that they could under the sun to pleasure themselves. Now, I'm not just talking sexually. I'm talking about anything that felt good. Rob, lie, steal, kill, the whole gamut, right? So they get Dad drunk and get Dad to impregnate them.
Who were the two
children that were born out of that incestual relationship? That incestual sexual relationship with Abraham.
Or excuse me, with Lot.
Moab. And Amon.
By who which
the tribes of the Moabites and the Ammonites were created, right?
Where did the lineage
of Jesus come from?
Both tribes.
Of Moab and Ammon. The Savior of the
world,
who sat at the right hand and sits at the right hand of God the Father, with the power of the Holy Spirit, who knew you in your mother's womb before your daddy had a twinkle in his eye with mommy. From a line of sexual incest amongst murderers, liars, thieves, etc. Came through King David, who in one fell swoop wiped all 10 commandments out when he went with Bathsheba. Ended up having Solomon, and so forth and so on. What's the whole point of all of this? Rethink
what you think
and believe
about the scripture,
about God, about your life, about your purpose in life, about 2020 and hindsight and your vision and your loneliness and your COVID and you're locked in the nursing home, or you're laid up in a wheelchair, or you're estranged from your family because of some argument 30 years ago that nobody remembers, because you're without a job, like me again, for the 173rd time in the last 15 years, that's not an exaggerated number, rethink.
Why?
Because what we think we know and what we believe may not necessarily be 100% accurate. And it might, it just might, cause you to choose to make decisions
that aren't necessarily
the decisions God wants you to make, or aren't necessarily healthy for you or your family.
Rethink. Abraham stopped
at 10. Is it a coincidence?
Lot
impregnated his daughters, so he was father and grandfather to two very important tribes, if you read the Old Testament at all, about the Moabites and the Ammonites, and how much fighting and death and different things and destruction that occurred through those tribes, amongst other tribes.
And Jesus came through all of that. So let me ask you, if the God of the universe,
who was
with the Father, because
John 1:1 tells us in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God, right? And Jesus is the Word. He's the bread of life. My brother Brent shared with me this morning, did you notice that the word Bethlehem, what does it mean, Brent?
House of bread.
House of bread. And Jesus says, I am the bread, right? Last week we talked about the well. I will give you water that you will never thirst again. I do not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. What words proceed out of the mouth of God? Well, there's roughly 300 and some thousand, I'm sure somebody knows that answer exactly, but there's 66 books here.
There are other books
that are not of the canon in the Bible that are very good for reading for historical purposes to help us rethink what we think we know,
because it isn't
about what we know, it's about who we know. And it isn't about who you know, but it's about who you serve.
And if you serve him,
that means you love him, because you choose to serve him, because he doesn't make you serve him.
And if you love
him, then you're obeying him. No, I don't have COVID. I have allergies. It's time to rethink.
Church, it's time to rethink.
America, it's time to
take all of our
blinders off, all of our colored shades, all of our everything, and open our eyes completely, not just to the Word of God, but to his Spirit and who we are in Christ and how we can be
a positive impact
for Jesus in 2021. Amen.
We can be more than we are. We don't even
have to fully understand. In fact, it's better that you don't fully understand everything. Because if you're like me, who are a little bit obsessive compulsive disorder, I kind of have control over everything. It's nice to know there are things in my life I don't have to have control over, like my salvation. That I can put 100% trust and faith in a man that died on a cross 2,000 years ago, who rose again and sits at the right hand of God the Father, currently interceding for me. And not just interceding for me,
knows me by name.
Yeah.
The Bible says
every hair that has ever been on my head is numbered. No matter how many of them I cut off, no matter how many we lose, okay?
Yeah. For those of you who have,
Char, what's that term? Malabisha? Malabisha. Where you don't have hair, God knows every hair and has it counted
before you were even conceived in your mother's womb.
Amen.
And if God knew you before you were conceived in your mother's womb,
that means your conception and those 9 months, 8 months, for you poor women who had to go through 10 months,
you're a person then. That whole time you're in mama's belly, God knew who you were then.
He knew you'd be when you got out, and he knew every day that you would spend on earth. And
he knew every sin you were ever going to commit
before you even had the intellect to verbalize or walk or do anything else. And he still died on the cross to save your soul. That doesn't excite you.
Then you're not
swallowing what God has really done.
Rethink what
you think you know about God. Rethink what you think you know about Christianity just because your uncle molested you, who was a pastor. Just because your aunt so-and-so, who was a devout Christian for 70 years, would treat you horribly. Just because, whatever it is, you want to fill in there.
Because I know a man
who did absolutely nothing wrong,
who fed thousands
of people physically and spiritually, who healed thousands of people.
By the touch of his
hand, some
faith was so strong,
like the soldier, didn't even have to go into their house, just spoke the word. Woo.
Man,
that's the God I serve.
And I don't want to serve a God that I can understand. If I can understand him, then he's not very good. He's puny. Because even at my best, intellectually, I am absolutely zero next to God.
That's the kind of God I
want to serve. Because why? Because when I put my confidence in him, I know it's covered. I don't have the OCD and worry about it. Because it's covered.
Gotcha.
Just like you're covered by the blood of Christ. Stand with me.
Amen. Here in the congregation.
Right to the Lord. Going to wish, Charlie, I'll shut it off. We're going to pray for those people on Facebook, YouTube. Again, this message is being delivered on December 13, 2020.
I don't care if you hear
this message on January 5th of 2046, if we're still here.
If you're listening to this message right now, whether
live, recorded later, 10 years from now, or whenever, you can
pray with me right now. And receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior.
Amen.
Pray with me. Father
in heaven, I may not understand everything that Pastor Steve's talking about, but I know what my heart feels right now. And I know that your son Jesus died on a cross to save me from my sin, and I accept him as my Lord and Savior. I believe that he came in the flesh, born of a virgin, died on the cross, rose again 3 days later, and sits next to God the Father in heaven, praying and interceding for me right now. I accept that. Father, I pray right now that you would give me the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit come and indwell in me and sanctify me from the inside out, Lord. Cleanse me. Lord, help me to be what you want me to be. If you pray
that prayer right now, I pray
you get a Bible, that you open it to the book of John, which is the fourth book in the New Testament. If you don't know where it is, there's an index in every Bible, okay? And start reading the book of John. And when you're done with that, read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then Acts. If you have questions, if you have problems, if you need prayer, reach out to my wife on Facebook. She'll get you to me. I will find a way to get news to you, whether it's by email or phone or Facebook or something. will get you connected to a church where you're at locally. When you're in Portsmouth, Ohio, for whatever reason, from wherever country you are, if I'm still alive, come visit us. Tell us you heard this message, even if it's 2046.
I'll be an old man then.
If the Lord tarries and he allows me to be around then, and pastoring here then.
We love you, God.
Bless you, drive safely.